Welcome to A Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and today I'm joined by Colin Watt, who is a regular contributor to A Celtic State of Mind, both the website, the podcast, and the live events. Colin, we're here doing daily podcasts. How are you managing the current situation?
I'll not lie, Paul, it's been a bit of a struggle. Looking at four walls every day, being told to work from home, not seeing anybody else apart from my girlfriend, and I love her dearly, but some social interaction is really missing, and hopefully soon football will be back and we'll be out and everything will go back to normal. But this is just such a strange period of time to be living in at the moment. It's
the isolation, it's the fear, it's the anxiety of the unknown. And what we've done here, it's coincided with a development with A Celtic State of Mind where we've created, I was going to say built, but we've created our own studio space, and we aim to put out podcasts every single day during this period. That's what we've pledged to do.
Yep.
It might give a wee bit of light entertainment for half an hour on an hour a day. It's not much, but it might help people through their day and when they're missing the football. And it's all about sparking some positivity and some football memories as well.
Well, I think people would rather that than some of the stuff that's coming out. I don't know if you've seen on Twitter, the team from the other side of Glasgow, their fanzines and their podcasts, they're doing virtual football games that were never going to be played, but they're going to see how they go on. We could beat 5-1 on Sunday if anybody paid any attention, and even Morelos got a goal. It was people want to, they still want their football fix, but it needs to be something that people can enjoy and something that people can relate to. And being here in Kafkin Park, as I said to you earlier, I was actually quite embarrassed that I've never been here before, because the surroundings and the history, from the minute you walk in the place, there was still a guy kicking a football about earlier. It shows that there's still a connection to this place. And honestly, I'd urge any Celtic fan listening now, get the opportunity and come out here. Come out and see Jim and the guys and take a look around, and you'll really be surprised at some of the memorabilia they've still got here and how Jimmy's legacy lives on. And I'm really proud that there's something like that here, and I'm proud that Axom have a place here in the Jimmy Johnson Academy, and proud to be a part of it.
We've named it the number 7 studio. I think we'll stick with that.
What was the idea behind the number 7?
You've had a walk around not only the park, because I saw you walking down the terracing earlier on, but you've had a wee walk around the pavilion, and the pavilion is a shrine to the achievements of Celtic's greatest ever player, James Connolly Johnston. What's the best or the most poignant thing you've seen within the pavilion?
Do you know, as I was saying, it's nice to see that his legacy's lived on. And when we were in the home dressing room and looking up and seeing that every shirt is above a picture of Jimmy, and just looking around and seeing that, and I can't imagine, I'd have loved to have played for Jimmy Johnson Academy. I'm not saying I was a great footballer. I had my time, and I played in some of the worst teams for Inverclyde, and people will know the likes of Reggie. He was a local Inverclyde legend. If you were caught skidging school, it was I'll crash you in, son. He was the school kind of liaison person that would catch you if you were off school. He'd say, I'll grass you in, son. You're like, no, Reggie, no. And they'd be like, all right, you can play for my team on Saturday and I'll not grass you into the school. So he had a team of misfits. Reggie's Rejects, they were called back in the day.
It's like Jossie's Giants, you remember that?
I think I'm too young for that, but you're showing your age here. But imagine playing for Jimmy Johnson Academy. In that, as I said, in the home dressing room, a picture of Jimmy above every shirt jersey. See, if you weren't having a great game, all you had to do is look up and see the picture of Jimmy and go, this is what I'm playing for, this is who I'm playing for. That would be enough inspiration for me to go out and run about there for 90 minutes, and I'm lucky if I can run for 90 seconds at the minute.
The thing as well, Colin, you're talking about playing football yourself. Anyone who played football, there's always these stories, that boy should have made it, or, you know, this guy should have made it. Everybody knows somebody that they believe should have made it. When you look back, did any of the guys you play with make the grade, or was there anybody you remember, even if the listeners haven't heard of them, that should have done, in your opinion?
When I was going through school, I mentioned to you earlier, I was in school with one of Stevie Fulton's nephews, Aidan. He made the grade through Celtic, was there from, I think he was 8, right through, wasn't allowed to play school football. That was the rules that Celtic gave him. You had to play for Celtic, you couldn't play for school team, couldn't play for the district or that. And Aidan made it right through until about 16, 17. And then that's the sort of age where they decide whether you're going to make it or they're going to let you go. They let Aidan go. And Aidan made it to Morton, our local team. He made about, I don't know, 6 or 7 appearances off the bench for Morton. This is when they're kind of going through this tough time. It was the season they get relegated, when they lost 10-2 to Hamilton on the last day of the season to go down. I think Hamilton needed to win by 8 or 9 goals to win the league that day, and they won 10-2. Nobody's ever looked into that, by the way. That would be an interesting one. But Aidan was one of the most gifted footballers. He was the star. We got to play football during our breaks and at lunchtime, and Aidan was always the first pick, always the first pick. And he could have made it. I think he really could have made it. He was left-footed, when there's a lack of left-footed players out there. He was really one of the best ones. I've got a lot of pals that still play Sunday League. They still play junior football. I don't know what it is. I think there's a generation now where if you've not made it by the time you're 17, 18, a lot of guys just, that's it. That's chuck it for them. They're happy to play on a Sunday. They're happy to go out on a Friday night and Saturday night and enjoy their weekend. But when it comes to the football, it's like, oh, I'll turn up on a Sunday if I'm needed, sort of thing. But I have some great guys. Still some guys I play sevens with now that are really talented footballers, but I think we've kind of lost that generation.
Potentially. The reason I ask is yesterday, where Jim O'Hara was looking through the Celtic views from 1997-98, and John Potter was in one of them. He, at that time, was the captain of the reserve team. John, I played football with John at school football and also with Valleyfield Boys Club. And I remember John getting signed as an S-form for Celtic. So it sparked off the memories. We all know somebody. But when I think of the guys, none of whom will be listening to this podcast, I don't think, because they're not Celtic fans. Brian Keaton signed for Falkirk. James Watt signed for Rangers. And a guy I know called Alexander Finlayson signed for Swindon Town. The best player at them all, incidentally, was a boy called Coco Bonner from Ballingery, but that's another story. But Alexander signed for Swindon, right? Steve McMahon was the manager. He loaned him out to Barry Town. And Barry Town always play in Europe because they always win the Welsh Cup at that time. So they drew some Russian team. And the front two was Shevchenko and Rebrov. And my mate sitting there as a 17-year-old playing for Barry Town, you know, against these two superstars. So it's interesting when you're up shoulders with some of these guys because you always know they had that wee bit extra, you know. But we are going to be talking about the greatest of ourselves. We're sitting in a room surrounded by Jimmy Johnson. Yep. So let's have a wee look at your Celtic team, Colin, through the ages. This changes depending on your era, your point of reference. So let's have a wee look at your Celtic team.
So very much like Kevin, I've started with Artur Boric in goal. For me, I kind of grew up in an era. I'll say my first game was Henrik Larsson's comeback game when he came on off the bench against Dundee United on the last day of the season.
I still think he had a moustache that day.
I'm yet to see this evidence, but if you see this evidence, then I'm sure he had a muzzle. No, oh, yeah.
I'm sure he had a moustache that day.
Now, that was my first game. My uncle took me to the games. He sat with his best friend. We sat in section 444, just in front of where the boys group are now. And I remember being, so I'm born in 93, so I was 5, going to my first game. And just everybody knew Henrik Larsson. So you were 3 or 4 and you were kicking a ball about the garden. I'm going to be Henrik Larsson. So getting to see that in the flesh, and I got to about maybe 5 or 6 games a season when Monk's friend couldn't make it. And I got to see Henrik Larsson in that through the years. So my kind of era starts sort of 99 through to the current day. So we're looking at guys like Rab Douglas, Artur Boric, Fraser Foster, David Marshall. But as Kevin's saying, there's something about Artur Boric that he just never made it to the right level. And I don't know if it was his temperament or what it was, but Kevin was telling the story, obviously, about him smoking in the showers. So maybe that was what it was. But honestly, craziest footballer I think I've seen play for Celtic, but one of the most gifted and one of the most talented goalkeepers ever. He could have made it so much a higher level than Celtic, and he's still playing now, so it's a testament to him.
He's still playing now. I think he got loads of mentions when we were talking about cult players and cult teams. You ran a number of polls. People didn't understand what a cult player was a lot of the time.
I don't think they still do.
For me, a cult player is someone who is incredibly gifted but doesn't apply himself, or applies himself with very little talent. And I think your Paddy McCourt had the talent, your Anton Rogan had the application, but they endear themselves to the Celtic fans. Because sometimes you look at Robin Friday or George Best and they could have done this and they could have done that because they had the talent, but they might have drank too much or they were womanizers or they didn't train hard enough. Artur Boric, I reckon, was a cult player because, as you say, he could have achieved more. He achieved loads in the game, let's be honest. He played so many international games, loads of trophies won, played in Italy, played in Poland, England, Scotland, but he could have done more.
The thing about Artur Boric that was always interesting was, do you remember why he was brought in? He was brought in because we shipped the 5 goals away at Art Media.
Came in on loan, didn't he?
He did, he came in on loan. Now, at that time, he was still kicking about the kind of Poland national team, and then when he sort of was loaned out, and you're going, well, why was a player at this stature loaned out? Because I know there was an agreement in his loan deal that we had the option to make it permanent, which we ended up doing. But guys like that, you're saying there's got to be a reason why he was loaned out in the first place, and somebody had to take a chance on him. And I think Gordon Strachan was the right guy to take a chance on him. I always say Gordon Strachan's one of the most underappreciated Celtic managers of recent times anyway. But the way he brought Arthur's game along, and as you've mentioned as well, Stevie Woods, it's really, really impressive. And the holy goalies, he's my number one. And Fraser Foster's not far behind, and I think Craig Gordon's been fantastic as well. But take me back to that night against Manchester United where he saves the penalty. He just, the place erupted. And take me back to any time that he wound up any Rangers fans at Ibrox or Parkhead. It was just, he's the one that I'll always remember.
Number one, right back?
Now.
Or are you playing me a right back?
I'm not playing me a right back.
See, I'm still got 4-4-2 in my mind, Colin.
So I'm going 3-4-3.
Right.
Interesting. So three centre-halves. First on the list, probably the least controversial one, is Virgil van Dijk. It is impossible now to
pick
a team.
No arguments from this side.
It's impossible now to pick a team from, say, maybe the late 80s to now and not have Virgil van Dijk in your side. Virgil van Dijk was always a player that was far too good for Celtic. And he knew it as well. What he still managed to do is have that temperament that when you needed him, he stepped up to the plate. But sort of towards the end, I think, he knew he was just kind of waiting for the next move to come along. He wasn't fully committed to Celtic. He still gave his heart on the park, but he just knew there was someone waiting to come along and give him that big money move. And fair play to him. I mean, second in the Ballon d'Or this year. What can you say about the guy? He was outstanding.
He was outstanding, but he had to make that next step. I remember speaking to Neil Lennon, and Lennon said that in the first training session, him and Mialby watched Van Dijk and didn't know where he should be playing. He could have been a midfield player. He says he could be playing anywhere.
Do you know what's interesting though? Since he's left Celtic, I don't know if he did it so much at Southampton, but he was a free kick genius at Celtic.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the free kicks he took against Dundee and against Hibs that were just outstanding. I've not seen him take anything since then.
I think the other thing Ronnie Dyler said when we interviewed him, and we interviewed him over the telephone.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, I didn't have the equipment to put the telephone straight into the sound desk. Mm. So it was a bit crackly. I think I would like to interview Ronnie again at some point. Maybe when we get the 9 in a row title, I'll give Ronnie a phone and we'll get a proper interview with him. Or he might invite me over to New York. But Ronnie, what he said was Van Dijk always had it in him to make that step, but he had to change his ways off the park. And I think he was talking about diet and lifestyle. So he's obviously done that to take the step up to Liverpool.
He's absolutely fantastic, and I think he's still only 29, 28, 29 or something.
I'm also thinking it would be a good night out so far. Boric, Van Dijk.
Oh, aye, definitely. And there's more to come that's going to make it an even better night out.
Right, who's playing alongside him? Near Beaton?
No, Near Beaton doesn't make this one. I'm going to go with Bobo Baldi. Bobo Baldi. What can you say that's not already been said about Bobo Baldi?
He couldn't pass.
He didn't need to. He was Bobo's going to get you. That is all you need to say about putting Bobo Baldi in your team. We had in Greenock, we had Tam McManus down to do one of the sportsman's dinners, and he told the story about playing against Bobo Baldi. He says, and it was him and Gary O'Connor up front, and he says he took a look at Bobo Baldi for the first time and went, I'm not going to get any joy against him. So he turns around to Gary O'Connor, who he says was not the brightest, and says, big man, you've got a chance against him. He's slow. You've got a pace. You can get in behind him. He's like, I think so, Tam, I can do it. And he says, aye, you can do it, son. He's like, right. So they swap positions. First time, ball goes over the top. Gary O'Connor just sitting. Bobo Baldi takes him out from behind. Free kick. Turns around to Tam McManus and goes, we're swapping back. I can't do this anymore. So Bobo Baldi put the fear of life into every forward that he came up against.
A man mountain.
And do you know what? He got stick for his contract situation at Celtic. I think he was the highest earner at that point. Wasn't playing. But do you remember the time? I think it was maybe 2006. He came back into the team under Gordon Strachan.
Yeah.
And he played. Celtic had struggled. They were conceding goals left, right and centre. And he came back in at centre-half. We were struggling defensively. And I think he played maybe 4 or 5 games. And we were a couple of clean sheets in that period of time. And I think the first one back was maybe Boxing Day at Tannadice.
Dundee United, yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And he got man of the match that day.
Remember it.
Considering he hadn't played, he played in the reserves games, he still did that, but he hadn't played a professional game of football in years. And he was, even when he played in the charity game not that long ago, he still looked a, a big physical presence, and he still looked as if he was kicking lumps out of people and the ball. So
and the socks right up over the knees. No argument. Who else is playing in defence?
Alongside those two, I'm going with another man mountain, Johan Mjelby.
This is a good night, right?
Well, as long as we're invited, it'll be even better. Johan Mjelby is part of that iconic treble winning side, and there was always something to be said about Mjelby, that he could win the ball in the air, but he could always win the ball at a corner. He was always one of them ones that was kicking around at a corner, and there was ones that it was hard to mark, especially when it was kind of an attacking corner for us. But he had a footballing brain, and you've seen that because he's now went on to do coaching, and he's alongside Neil Lennon, or he was alongside Neil Lennon, and he's certainly got a footballing brain about him. And Van Dijk's got a footballing brain about him. Mjelby's got a footballing brain about him. Baldy's taking out that striker that goes through the middle. So that is my back three.
I'm liking the sound of this. I'm liking the sound of this, Colin. Is there a wee bit more flair when we go into the midfield?
Oh, definitely. So if we move on to right midfield, as I would call it, Shinsuke Nakamura. What a player. Absolute what a player. If my mum's listening, it was her favourite player. My wee Nakamura, she called him. But the guy had absolutely everything. Don't get me wrong, there was times where you were digging out games. Sort of. It seemed to always be when we got towards Christmas time. We'd bring in guys like Evander Snow and Derek Riordan. We'd always dig out, like we drew with Hibs and St Mirren and stuff like that at home at those periods of time. And Nakamura always seemed to be a luxury player. But when it got onto a European stage or when it got onto a Celtic Rangers game, he was always, always the guy that was going to create something. And that goal against Alan McGregor was just iconic. McGregor will say that it moved in the air and he wasn't positioned, but no, Nakamura knew exactly what he was doing. As soon as that ball left his foot, he knew it was going back into the net.
And you can watch that and watch it watch it again. What a strike.
Now, I think if you ever get the chance to interview Gary Caldwell, he'll say it's his best assist. Because it was him that actually plays the ball.
I don't think he meant it, though.
He didn't. That was the thing.
Was he not going for the corner flag?
He probably was.
Scuffed it.
And it ended up at Nakamura's feet.
I've never interviewed Gary Caldwell. He's welcome on the podcast. I would speak to him.
Gary, if you're listening, get in touch with us. Get in touch with Paul. DM him. He's always open.
DM's always on. Nakamura, next.
So, moving into the midfield, he'll be the captain as well, and he's our current captain, it's Scott Brown.
Hillabeath.
When Scott Brown first signed for Celtic, there was always a period of time where you could watch
him. He was wearing a terrible pair of jeans.
I remember that. Mm-hmm. I also remember it got announced that we were signing him while Scotland were playing in, I think it was the Kirin Cup. It was announced on BBC Scotland at that point. And there was always a period, though, where Scott Brown was maybe lost the ball in midfield and he was tracking the guy back, and you just knew 9 times out of 10 he's going in for the back and he's going to be a foul and it's going to be a yellow card. Now, we must have lost Scott Brown for quite a few games at that period of time, and I think he gets sent off against Manchester United, is that right? Or Barcelona, one of the two.
Barcelona, certainly, yep.
And since then, his maturity levels have been incredible. How far he's came on as a player has been outstanding. I don't know how much that had to do with how quick he had to grow up when he lost his sister. And obviously the story about that and Tommy Burns is a fantastic story for anybody that's not heard it before. But Scott Brown grew up so quickly in that period of time. And now, even at the age of, I think we're saying the other day, he's 35 now, he's so influential in that Celtic midfield. And there's got to be a place in the coaching staff for him going forward. He will go down, regardless of what anybody else thinks. He will go down as one of Celtic's greatest ever players.
I think that's one of these things now, Colin, where you can't really argue because of the honours that he's won. He's leading this club to 9 in a row, if and when that happens, when it happens. Mm-hmm. And beyond that, and you look at the appearances, I asked the question the other day, how many more seasons of 50 games can we get out of Scott Brown? He's coming up for 35. Can he play on to the age of 37, 38?
Well, see, that's the thing, mate. So I've found that when Scott Brown gets injured now, it takes him longer to come back. And that's part of his age, right? That's to be expected. But when Scott Brown gets a run of 6 or 7 games, he is at the top of his game and he's as good as he was 5 or 6 years ago. So I think as long as Scott Brown stays injury free, he'll be an asset to Celtic. But I'd like to see him transition to a role where he's coming on with maybe 30 minutes to go and you're trying to kill a game out, because he's got that ability to break down the middle of the park. He does probably slow the game down, but for Celtic at times that's not a bad thing, because at times when we go 100 miles an hour, we end up conceding. Take a look at the last the Copenhagen game. we're going 100 miles an hour as soon as that ball hits the back of the net. And what happens? We go and concede, and that's us, we're out.
I'm just impressed that you can go out and eat kebabs and have a bevy and still be as fit and slim. If I do that, I need to go on a treadmill for about 3 weeks. You kind of go over that pretty quickly, and I think Brendan Rodgers played a big part in the recent turnaround in form, which he's continued, obviously, under Neil Lennon.
Definitely, and I think if Kevin was saying the other day, the fact that he stepped away from international football has probably done him the world of good. You see the likes of Tom Rodgick, when he disappears to go to Australia, can take him 3 or 4 weeks to actually get back into it. So Scott Brown knew what he was doing for his career, and that's good. It's good for us, to be fair. As long as Scott Brown thinks he's still got the legs and the body, then I'd say there's a contract here for him.
So who else is going to make up this midfield?
So this is a hard one. So I was looking through some of the guys. You know personally that I think Joe Ledley is one of the most underappreciated Celtic players, and I just don't think he was here long enough to make it into that 11 that I've seen. So I'm going to go with Stelian Petrov. Mm-hmm. Stelian Petrov's story at Celtic is absolutely unbelievable. Signed by John Barnes, is that right? And then he ends up working at his pal Burgervan just to learn English and starts playing at right back and then moves in. The only thing about Stelian Petrov that still irks me a wee bit to this day is the day that he decided he was leaving Celtic. Celtic had lifted the title, everybody was having a party, and he was just first one straight down the tunnel. And in interviews since, he has come out and said that is his biggest regret, is mm-hmm. that he didn't enjoy the celebrations. Because I think he only maybe won one more trophy after that with Villa. But Petrov was one of those players, if you watch back the treble winning season under Martin O'Neill, Petrov goes box to box. He picks a ball up in his own 18-yard box, and within 10 or 15 seconds, it's up in the other 18-yard box. And his energy was absolutely outstanding. Mm-hmm. And you need someone like that in that park, especially the formation I'm playing. If Scott Brown's holding, Stelian Petrov can run up and down the park all day. Some of the goals he scored, his free kicks at Ibrox, he was outstanding. And I think Bulgaria will even turn around and say he's probably one of their best ever players as well. So if he doesn't make it into our Celtic team, there's a bit of an issue.
I always remember it was Stoichkov that gave him the glowing report when we were trying to get the work permit for him when he signed. You've got another midfielder in this team.
Yep, so this was a hard one. Although it's kind of playing a left side, it would be very difficult to exclude someone like James Forrest. I watched back as part of this working from home and self-isolation nonsense. I watched back the first season that Lennon lifted the trophy. Now, I believe that's the first season that James Forrest played a complete run of games, and we're talking that's like 10 years ago now. So for someone like James Forrest still to be at Celtic, he'll be one of those ones that'll break into the 500 club, I reckon. And he's close to 100 goals as well, so that's phenomenal. And it's probably between him and Aidan McGeady for me. Aidan McGeady was one of the most talented players I've ever seen at Celtic Park. He had this gift of totally turning a game round on his own. I remember watching the game where Celtic went up to Pittodrie and he did the flick for the first time. And I think it was Satanta that was the broadcaster at that time. They rewound it and rewound it and rewound it and rewound it and ended up on all these clips. It was on Soccer AM, it was on all this. And it was as if someone like Messi or Ronaldo had done it. And it ended up, I think it ended up as part of an official move on FIFA.
Really?
Now, if you're doing something that gets an official named move on FIFA, then you're doing well. I only think the problem with Aidan was his career went downhill as soon as he went to Russia. And that could be said for a lot of people. He openly admits he didn't want to go, but he was kind of forced out the door. Celtic needed the money at the time. What would have happened if Aidan McGeady had stayed at Celtic? Would some of the guys that have got the chance now had the chance to get through? Maybe not. But he could have went on and he could have been a 500 guy. And he always says that his inspiration was Tommy Burns. And I think if he'd stayed, he would have been in that ilk.
Mm-hmm. And his dad played for Sheffield United alongside Jimmy Johnson. So there you go, there we've made up the midfield. What about your forward? There's plenty to choose from. Who's going to make the grade up front for you?
So I'm going to start with our current French god and Odson Edouard. What can be said about Edouard that's not already been said? He's only 22 I think, and the world is his oyster. He could go and play for almost any team now because he's got such natural ability, and he's at an age where he's still developing as well. So whoever picks him up is going to get one of the best players. He's going to be a mainstay in the French national team alongside Dembele when the two of them make it in there.
We've done all right with Frenchmen, though. Stéphane Bonn, he was French.
Stéphane Mahé.
Mahe, but he was fine. Actually, Stephen Mahe, now that you mention him, he appears in one of the Not the Views I've got here in Great Celtic Haircuts of Our Time, where it looked as though he'd done it himself, and it was a Travis Bickle, give himself a Mohican. Can you remember that?
Probably not, but I'm looking forward to seeing the picture of it later on. Celtic Haircuts, wow. Are you going to do a feature on that?
Could they'll do well. They're Not the Viewer way ahead of me with that. Way ahead of me.
It's retro. We'll bring it back.
Who are you going to partner up with, Edward?
I'm going to go with Musa. I mean, if we'd ever got a season with them two up front, all goal scoring records would have been broken. We've seen it for sort of 3 or 4 months when Edward first signed for Celtic on loan. That day at Ibrox, when we came back to win 3-2, the connection between those two was outstanding. We had a couple of games before Dembele moved on. I think we beat Livingston 3-1 at Celtic Park, and the connection between those two was outstanding. I think if it wasn't for Dembele moving away, Edward probably wouldn't have got as many chances as he got. But if he'd got those two together, they would have been outstanding. Golden Boot winners, definitely.
You've still got another player to pick.
I wonder who it would be.
It's quite incredible. We've got a number 7 jersey in here. I'm looking up at a picture of Jinky with the one and only King of Kings.
Of course, it's Henrik. I mentioned earlier I got to see Henrik in the flesh, and unbelievable. There's nobody that'll ever be as good as Henrik Larsson. Edward, everyone says Edward's the best since Larsson, and I can't disagree with that. But Henrik was just, it was something else.
In the 97-98 season, Tosh McKinley headbutted him at Barrowfield, broke his nose. He comes back and he leads Celtic to their first title in 10 years. Against Lyon, he breaks his leg. I remember thinking, is that his shin guard poking out his sock there? It was his shin bone. He comes back stronger after his recuperation with Brian Scott. And I remember when he shaved off his dreadlocks. He did a few, I say bad games. They weren't bad games, maybe by his standard. And he shaved the hair off. And then he scored against Aberdeen, the skinhead, do you remember?
Tawdry.
So these things happen, Larsson comes back better and better, but it was a consistency, and we're talking about number sevens, and it was Andy Lynch actually that said to me that he played with a number seven in Kenny Dalglish, and his son Simon played with Henrik Larsson, and when they have a discussion, they're almost talking about the same player, and that's in terms of the way that they approached the game, the way that they trained, prepared, and the standard that they set actually on the pitch.
See, the thing about Henrik that I think is kind of greatly underappreciated is how much of a team player he actually was. I mean, he set all these records, 53 goals in a season, 242 goals in total. But if you speak to like Sutton and Hartson, which I know you've done on several occasions, and we've spoke to Hartson, and he always say how Henrik was the first person to lay them on for a goal. They were never, if Henrik found someone in a better position than what he was in, he would always leave it on for someone else. Henrik could have scored over 300 goals for Celtic. He had that ability to do so, but he was never a selfish player. Never a selfish player.
His first and last goals at Celtic Park were both against Celtic.
Barcelona in the Champions League, when he lobbed it over David Marshall. And the, say that again, the first and,
his first and final goals at Celtic Park were both against Celtic. Check the wiki, it's on there. So there's your greatest 11, right? What strips are they wearing, home and away?
Right, so we've had this, You're obviously doing a book at the minute of all the greatest.
Just for the last 5 years, Colin.
I mean, it's just,
I might have mentioned it once or twice.
It's a wee part-time thing. Home kit, I think what Kevin was saying the other day about the treble winning home kit with the NTL across it, that there's something to be said about that. I think that's a fantastic kit. In recent times, I don't think there's been many home kits that have really stood out. At the minute, we're doing the Decade of Dominance Awards, and part of that is a home kit over the last 10 years, and even when I was looking at those, there's not many that kind of stand out. The ones that had the special badges for sort of the 50th anniversary of Lisbon and things like that, they're obviously a bit iconic, but I think going back, I would love to have an NTL top with Larsson 7 on the back of it. So that would be my
so that's the home kit. What about the away jerseys?
So for me, there's been more iconic away jerseys than what there's been home jerseys. I guess it's very easy to put hoops on a top. Is what you do after that. Declan was mentioning the 125th anniversary tops, and we had the third kit that season, which was the white top with the black collar. I actually wore that the night that we beat Barcelona at Celtic Park, and it's, for the life of me, I can't find it in Mum and Dad's house, and I think they've thrown it out, and that's one of the things that brings me most sadness, is that I've not still got that top, because I think that was iconic.
I remember a Celtic top went missing in my house, and I found it in my brother's wardrobe with a hot rock bun on it.
So that was well hidden from you.
It was well hidden.
My brother actually
don't ask why I was looking in his wardrobe.
I know you still share shirts, it's alright. I was speaking with my brother, and my brother's just got his first full time job. He's just left school, and he texted me the other day and he sent me a picture, and it was the retro top, the yellow and green retro top. I think it's from the 80s. You know what I'm talking about?
Yellow and green. I'm thinking of the yellow away kit. Is this the one with the zigzag design on it? Space Invaders design?
No, this is simpler. The 80s. This is the one that Celtics released as a retro.
So the centenary top, yellow with the green and white collar. We wore that in the centenary season, yeah.
So, now he was born in 2003, and he's telling me that's a fantastic top. So it just shows you that through the ages, there's Celtic tops that emanate with people, and that's certainly one of them. And for me, it's between that one and the green and black one that we mentioned the other day. Mm-hmm. My friend Jordan actually spent £90 on a real kit from back then on one of those retro websites, and he says it's one of his most pride possessions, that he spent £90 one day on that. But sorry Jordan, I'm going to go with the yellow with the green and white.
Great jersey. Actually reminds me of Capo. I know that you're from Greenock. Mm-hmm. We're going to speak about Greenock in a second or two, but the games that we played around that time, we always had that yellow kit on. I remember McAvenny scoring 4 at Capello wearing that yellow top, and he was one of the few players that wore the long sleeves, you know. Mm-hmm. Frank McAvenny. So yeah, great team, great kits. And I do also ask the question, Colin, the Celt that you think got away, a player that you would have loved to have seen in the hoops.
So I was thinking about this when you asked me the other day, and actually it's a bit unfortunate timing that we've found out yesterday that Peter Whittingham passed away, the Cardiff City midfielder. He was a Cardiff City legend. I think he played between 2003 and 2016, I think, for them. And he played in the same team as Joe Ledley, and this was a team that was getting promotion into the, mm-hmm. the Premier League. And at that time, sort of when we signed Joe Ledley, Peter Whittingham was always one that I thought would have been sort of player for Celtic. This is the sort of time when Aidan McGeady was starting to move away. So we're looking for a left-sided midfielder, and Whittingham could score from anywhere. I think he scored 25 goals one season from left midfield, playing off the striker. And he was always one that I thought Celtic really could have got. And I think he obviously passed away the other day, aged 35. So there's still a great person, coach, player still in there. And obviously, best regards to his family. I know there's probably not many Cardiff City fans listening, but he was really a Bluebird legend. So in that kind of era, it was maybe him. And one that I've always thought was a sort of one that could have turned round the season for Celtic was Stephen Fletcher.
Absolutely.
Stephen Fletcher, I mean, I think when I was listening to him on another podcast, sorry Paul, I listened to another podcast.
A Celtic one?
No, it wasn't.
That's all right.
But he was saying basically he thought he was going to Celtic. Mm-hmm. He was almost convinced he was going to Celtic. He told his friends and his family he was going, and then Petrie and Lawwell just couldn't strike out a deal. I think there was only a couple of £100,000 of a difference, and then he goes down south. And he says basically the way he was treated when he went down south, it was as if he was going to be the next god down there. And he says for that reason, that was the reason he went down there. And He is a Celtic fan. Stephen Fletcher is a Celtic fan.
So Celtic lose out on a player because Petrie and Lowell are arguing to toss over a couple of hundred grand. Where have we heard that?
Fast forward maybe 10 years and we'll see what happens.
Mm-hmm. No, Fletcher I thought would have been a great buy for us as well. And one of the things again that I bang on about, and this is because of my age and the fact that I was in amongst it, is the fanzine culture. But you brought a couple of your own Celtic books along. Yep. With you today, Colin. Talk us through the relevance and the significance of the books you brought along.
So, as I mentioned earlier, it was my uncle that started taking me to the games. When I was brought up, my biological father was never around. My mum brought me up along with my gran, and my uncle James always took me to the games. And any time he could get a ticket, he'd take me. And I still go with actually his friends group. Now I still sit with them. And they've had those seats ever since Celtic Park was redeveloped. And he would always be the one to bring in sort of Celtic memorabilia to the house. He bought me my first kit. He would always give me books. And these books here are actually his sons. I've sent him them. And that was how I started my sort of knowledge base of Celtic, was listening to his stories about where he found his love for Celtic. Mm-hmm. How he got taken to the games, how he'd skidge work or skidge school to get to the games, back when you could get thrown over the turnstile and the history of Celtic was always from him, and I've got to thank him for that. I mean, I could have been supporting Morton, nothing against Morton, but I'd rather be supporting Celtic.
I'm glad to hear it. The first one is The Glory and the Dream, and
yep,
this was the first Celtic book I ever read, and it's of course written by Tom Campbell and Pat Woods, two yep. men who I've got to know really well. Had a really strange experience, actually, because I remember Noel Gallagher telling a story that he was doing a signing session, and it gets to the point where you're signing stuff and passing it on without even looking up.
Yep.
And somebody says to him, could you sign that to Lars? And he says, like that knobhead out of Metallica, and he turned up and there's Lars Ulrich standing there, right? So it was actually that knobhead wow. from Metallica. And I remember my first book launch, and people were coming up to get the Quality Street Gang signed. Uh-huh. This old guy came up, very unassuming, with the glasses. It was Pat Woods. I said, I'm not signing my book for you, Pat. You're the reason I write Celtic books, you know? And I've got to know him, and he's a walking encyclopedia. So, yeah, a very important book in Definitely. The history of Celtic literature, without a doubt, is A Glory and a Dream. Fantastic read.
It's actually quite interesting because it's the first 100 years of Celtic within that book. And obviously, you're saying Pat's now of a good age. It'd be interesting to see if they would ever do a follow-up to it from 1987 onwards.
I think Tom Campbell's up for that. I'll speak to him later. I'm working on something with Tom. And the other one, again, very, very close to my Celtic upbringing, you've brought along a book called Sack the Board.
Yep. So, obviously, yourself and I, we run an event celebrating 25 years since the takeover of Celtic. It was fantastic to have David Lowe and Kevin McKenna there and to hear the stories from back then, because... So that happened when I was 6 months old. Sorry to make you feel old, Paul.
It does make me feel old, because that was at that time I would go through on a bus that ran from Blair Hall. So if anybody knows Fife, it's probably a couple of miles down the road from where I lived, and I would walk to get the bus for a guy called Jokey Munyon, right, who was actually related to me.
Yep.
And he used to speak about driving to the San Siro in 1970 to watch the European Cup final. And we were going to watch a dreadful Celtic team in disarray with a rubbish stadium and a board that was just bleeding the club dry. And it was hearing all these guys' stories, calling of the good old days, and thinking, as a young guy, we'll never have that success again. That was the feeling. You'll never have the success again. And then there was this massive Sack the Board campaign that came from the fanzine culture. It was a street movement, but obviously, as David quite rightly says, nothing can happen at street level. You need the businessmen,
yep.
you need the financial savvy, and that's what Ferguson, David Lowe and others brought in. But they were rattled, the board were rattled by the street movement, by the fanzine movement, by Save Ourselves and Celts for Change. And then the likes of Ferguson and David came along, and the rest is history.
And it's history that really shouldn't be forgotten, because it does show the power of the fan. I think the first game that we're talking about right about that era would have been Kilmarnock at home in 94, There was maybe 12,000 Celtic fans there that day. That was the official attendance, but a lot of people would say it was a lot less than 12,000 there that day. Now, you can't even imagine what 12,000 would be like at Celtic Park nowadays. Even for friendlies and third round of the League Cup, you don't even get that anymore. Even under Ronnie Dyla, when fans were kind of shying away with that European campaign where we shut the top tier, there was still more than 12,000 there. So the fan power back then should never be underestimated. And the guys that done all the work in the background, as you're saying, Sales for Change, Save Ourselves, and even the other fans groups like the CSA and this Association of Celtic Supporters and that, the work that they done to save our club was absolutely fantastic. And for me, I can't imagine there not being a Celtic there to support. So from my generation, it is a massive thank you to these people. And it just shows the difference that one fans group can have against another fans group when we can save a club and maybe certain others can't.
No, I think that's a fantastic point. And we had that event in a fantastic Celtic supporters club. And I don't say that lightly. I'm not just saying that because you're here. But the Greenock CSC, is it Laird Street in Greenock?
Yep.
What a club that is. It's a brilliant place to go and do live events.
Mm-hmm.
The people are great. You're involved in the club. Tell us a wee bit about the Greenock and the success of the CSC.
So this year is actually a massive year for Greenock. We are celebrating, well, hopefully once all this dies down, we will be celebrating our 75th anniversary. And I think there was a recent bit of research done to show that we're probably the third or fourth oldest Celtic supporters club in history. But I think we're actually the still longest running. So it's a fantastic club, and it's still got the eminence from way back 75 years ago. There's guys, founding members, that have only just recently passed away. Guys in their 90s that were still wanting to go and go down to the club and to go and see Celtic. The bus facility that they run out of there, there's five or six buses going to every home game, bus to every single away game. And the way that the club's run is, as I say, I'll probably be a bit biased because I'm on the committee there, but it's a very, very well-run club. For this day and age, for a club of that size to be running independently on its own, it's not as if it's a bar where a Celtic bus runs out of. It's a dedicated Celtic supporters club, and they're few and far between now. Probably you've got the association on London Road, and that's maybe in Irvine. I'm trying to think of...
The one in Dumbarton, Dumbarton Harp, maybe? Dumbarton Harp?
I haven't been over to Dumbarton, but if that's the case, then yeah, I mean... But as you can see, there's few and far between. And I know there's some great supporters clubs out there, like Declan's, Betty Old and Mary Hill. But they run out of pub, whereas there's to have a dedicated supporters club for Celtic, I think it is few and far between. And it's just a place for people to go and speak to their friends. And long may it continue. We'll hopefully be celebrating the 75th, and then we'll be celebrating the 100th soon, and we'll take it from there. But it's open to anybody, so if we ever get a chance to play Morton, if Morton ever make it into the Premier League, the doors will always be open, and anyone that's visiting the Greenock area, feel free to take a nip in and take a look at some of the memorabilia. We've got Ronnie Simpson, Lisbon jacket, you've seen that.
Mm-hmm.
We've got the main wall upstairs with all the Celtic photos throughout the years. There's lots of Celtic memorabilia. There's a first ever Celtic view in there.
Is there?
I don't know if you've seen that.
I've not seen that one. Down. You see it, all are welcome. Does that include Martin Compson?
That's for another podcast. Do you know what? Martin is a lovely, lovely guy. And his success has probably brought a lot of interest to the Inverclyde area. But Martin will be the first to admit that he was a bit of a... Willie to swear?
You can say what you like.
He was a wee bit of an arsehole when he was growing up. And he knows that himself. His character on Sweet 16 wasn't far off the kind of person he was. But he's done a lot of growing up, and I think there'll be a time when Martin will make amends with the Greenock Celtic, hopefully not in the too distant future.
Let's hope so. It's a special place, and I hope, Colin, that we can go there again and do some more events, because it's always a great night. We are putting out daily podcasts on a Celtic state of mind, a wee bit of light relief during some difficult times. Hopefully everybody's enjoying the daily podcast. I'm certainly enjoying staying up to midnight to edit them at night time. Colin, it's been an absolute pleasure, and hopefully we can do it again sometime soon.
Thanks for having us, Paul, and thanks for being around when the start time's upon us.